Good morning, students, and once again I welcome you all for the digital classroom of science lecture. Dear students, in the last lecture we had started with lesson number 6, composition of matter, and we were not able to complete the lesson. We had only finished half of the lesson. So today we are going to continue with the remaining part of the lesson, that is composition of matter. If you remember, I had given you the example of bhel when we prepared the bhel, or the bonvita milk or tea. These are all the mixtures. Mixtures means when two or more than two substances are added in any proportion, and each and every constituent has its own properties, then it is called as a mixture. So we will study about the different types of mixtures. Now there are two types of mixtures: homogeneous mixture and heterogeneous mixture. Before that, we have to learn one more heading or one more new word, that is phase. Phase is the part of matter having uniform composition. A mixture can have one single phase, or it can have more than one phases also. That is, you can say in simple words, these are the parts of the mixture. Now first one, homogeneous mixture. Homo means uniform, same. When all the components of the mixture, they form one single phase, then it is called as a homogeneous mixture. Like blood, we had studied that blood is made up of RBC, WBC, platelets and the liquid plasma. But they are all mixed together and they form one single phase. That is, they both are in the same matter, state of matter. Similarly, milk. So it is a homogeneous mixture. Next is heterogeneous mixture. Hetero means different. When the components of mixtures are distributed into two or more phases, that means the substances in a mixture, when they are in different states of matter, they can be very clearly distributed or separated, then it is called as a heterogeneous mixture. So a components of mixture, when they can be divided into two or more phases, then it is called as a heterogeneous mixture. Example, ice cubes in cola. Any cold drink, when we put ice cubes, that is a heterogeneous mixture. And salt, pepper, that is also a heterogeneous mixture. Now there are certain things which you have to remember in the different types of mixtures. Like when all the particles of a solid that stay together or are in the same container constitute a single phase. Now these are the different types of the mixtures. So the first one is solid in solid, that is the heap of stones. Next is a liquid substance along with all the soluble substances dissolve in it together constitute a single phase. Now in the first one, heap of stones, all the substances, all the particles were solid and they were in the same container. Sorry. Whereas in this one, like seawater example, in seawater there are different soluble substances dissolve in it, but still they are forming a single phase. Then the next example is raindrops. In raindrops, all its drops are present together or they form a single phase. Then oil and water. You know, during Diwali we lit diyas, and certain diyas, you know, they are filled with water, and on top of that oil is poured, and then with the help of a wooden frame the cotton wick is put in it. You know why? So that whole amount of the oil can be used. Now when oil and water are mixed together, they do not mix with each other. You can very clearly see the different line, that is the separation between the oil and the water. So when the liquids together are present in the same container, but they are not mixed with each other. They are separate. Then they constitute a separate phase, that is oil and water. Then air. Air is a mixture of gases, but they all form a single phase. So this is all the different examples which we see in our day-to-day life. Then next we have to study new things: solution, solvent, solute, dissolution. Now see in the picture below, you can see very clearly the first one is salt, right? Then we have water in a bottle. Now when we add this salt in the water, the taste of the water changes, right? It becomes salty water. If instead of salt we take sugar, then it will be a sweet water. Now when these two things are mixed together, like we are mixing salt in water, so salt is taken in small amount and water is taken in larger amount, right? So the substance or the component which is taken in small amount is called as a solute, and the component which is in large proportion is called as the solvent. And the new component or the new solution which is formed, the new liquid, right, rather, which is formed, that is called as a solution, right? Now in this case, salty water is a solution. If we add sugar, it will be the sweet water, that will be the solution. So solution is a homogeneous mixture of two or more substances, right? Like salt solution or sugar solution. Solvent, component of the solution which is present in larger proportion. Here it is water. Solute, the component which is taken in less amount or less proportion is called as solute. Like in the given picture, it is salt. Now, what is dissolution? Now, the process of forming a solution by mixing solute and solvent is called as dissolution. When we are making a solution with the help of solute and solvent, then this new formed substance is called as solution, but the process is called as dissolution, right? Now next is, these solutions can be of different types on the basis of the components, that is on the basis of solute and solvent, right? So on the basis of the states of the compound, whether they are solid, liquid or gas, these are different types. The first one is liquid in liquid type, that is the solvent is also liquid and solute is also liquid. And the example is dilute sulfuric acid. Sulfuric acid is H2SO4. Then gas in gas, that is the solute is gas and the solvent is also gas, like air. Air is a mixture of different gases. Then solid in solid, that is the solute is also solid and solvent is also solid. We had studied about the alloys like brass and steel. These are made up of two different elements and both solute and solvent are solid. The next is gas in liquid. When the gas is present in the liquid solvent, that is called as the gas in liquid solution. And the examples are hydrochloric acid and chlorinated water, right? Now during the rainy season, you know, when you just smell the tap water, there is a particular smell in that water. That is because chlorine gas is added in the water, that is gas and liquid, so that it can disinfect the water. So these are the different types of solutions based on the state of matter of solute and solvent. Next is suspension. Now suspension is also a type of solution where the liquid and solid are mixed together. That is, in a liquid, the solid particles are dispersed, right? So such a heterogeneous mixture is called as a suspension. Now these solid particles, they are big enough, right? And thus they form two phases. One is liquid, and that is the solvent, and the solid, that is the solute. So these solid particles are big enough and they can be separated by filtration. Filtration means we have a filter paper. When we'll go to the lab, I will show you. It has pores in the paper, and with the help of the filter paper, we can separate the solid particles of suspension and separate both the phases. Example, sawdust and water. If we take water as a solvent, and if we add sawdust in it, we can see very clearly that sawdust does not disperse uniformly in the water. They can be very clearly seen, and if we use a filter paper and separate it, or if we use a sieve, you know, challni, which we call. So if we use that, we can very easily separate the sawdust and water. So this is all about the suspension. The next is a colloid. Now colloid is, you know, in one substance which can be divided into minute particles, and it is dispersed throughout a second substance. Like milk, we know that there are different components in the milk. They are very, very small. So these particles which are dispersed in the milk are very small. They cannot be seen through our naked eyes. So such a solution is called as the colloid, and this cannot be separated. These solid particles cannot be separated by the filter paper because these dispersed particles are quite big. Like solid in gas, when we see the smoke, there are carbon unburned particles in the gas. So that is an example of colloid. Then clouds. Clouds are liquids in gas, right? So these are all the examples of the colloid. So these are the different types of solution. Then the next is molecular formula and valency. Now we had studied about the symbols of the elements. Symbols are the abbreviations or short forms for the names of the elements. It is written with a capital letter, and if two elements are having the same letter, then we write the second letter also, but the second letter is small and the first letter is capital. So using these symbols, we can write the molecular formula of the different different compounds. Now molecular formula indicates the number of atoms of each of the constituent elements present in one molecule of a compound. Students, we had studied about the molecular formula of very common compounds like carbon dioxide, water. Carbon dioxide is CO2, right? That means in one molecule of carbon dioxide, one atom of carbon and two atoms of oxygen are present, right? So CO2 is the molecular formula, and C is an atom, O is also an atom of carbon dioxide. And we can also make out from this molecular formula that one atom of carbon. See, when no number is written at the base of the symbol, then it means it is one. So C, carbon atom, is one in number, where below O at the base two is written. That means there are two atoms of oxygen, and one atom of carbon plus two atoms of oxygen, it makes three atoms of one molecule of carbon dioxide. So there is a definite proportion of the constituent elements in a compound. Certain number of the atom of the constituent elements are joined to each other in a molecule of a compound, right? The molecular formula indicates the number of atom of each of the constituent elements present in one molecule of a compound. That means if we are having a molecular formula, we can easily find out the number of atoms in the molecule as well as the number of elements in the molecule, right? Like I gave you the example of CO2, that is carbon dioxide. So carbon is one atom, oxygen two atoms, total comes to three atoms. So one molecule of carbon dioxide is made up of three atoms, out of which one atom is carbon and two atoms are oxygen. So this is all about molecular formula. Second example I am giving you of HCl, that is hydrochloric acid. As you can see, the molecular formula of hydrochloric acid is HCl. Now H stands for hydrogen, that is the symbol of hydrogen, and Cl, as I told you that if two elements are starting with the same alphabet, then we take the second alphabet also for one of the element, and that is written in small letter. Now chlorine starts with C, carbon starts with C, calcium starts with C. So how to find out now which element is shown by this? So we used the symbol for carbon, it is C, for calcium it is C small a, for chlorine it is C small l, right? So this is how we write the symbols. This we had already studied in the previous class. So here H and Cl, these are the two constituents of hydrochloric acid. So molecular formula of hydrochloric acid is HCl. This is one molecule which is made up of one atom of hydrogen and one atom of chlorine. So one molecule of hydrochloric acid is made up of two atoms, one hydrogen and one chlorine. I hope you have understood the molecular formulas, how to find out the number of atoms and number of constituent elements present in one molecule of a compound, right? Then what is valency? Valency again we had studied in 7th standard, and if you remember in 7th standard when we had studied about the electronic configuration of an atom, we had studied about the different orbits K, L, M, N, where the electrons are distributed. And there we had studied that the outermost shell of an atom is also called as the valency shell, right? And to be very simple, the number of electrons present in the outermost shell or in the valency shell is called as valency, right? Now we will study in detail about the valency. This is what we had studied in the previous class. The ability of joining another atom with a chemical bond is a chemical property of each atom. This is how the compounds are formed, right? The atoms of different elements, they combine together with the help of the chemical bond, and that is the property. Now this ability is indicated by a number, and this number is called valency of that atom. So what did I say earlier? The electrons which are present in the outermost shell or the valency shell, that is the number of the electrons, and the same is called as the valency. So an atom form as many as chemical bonds with other atom as its valency. So the property of joining with another atom depends upon the valency, and valency is the number of electrons present in the outermost shell of an atom. Okay, so this is all about valency. Now the next is cross multiplication method for writing the molecular formula of simple compounds. Now if we know the valencies of the different atoms, in the compound, then we can easily write down the molecular formula. Now there are the different steps, so please concentrate and listen carefully. Now very first step is we have to write the symbols of the constituent elements, right? Now suppose we want to write the molecular formula of carbon dioxide. So we know that it is made up of two constituents, that is carbon and oxygen. We know the symbols also of carbon and oxygen. It is capital C and capital O. So very first step is we have to write capital C and capital O, that is the symbols of the constituent elements. Second step, we have to write the valency below the respective element. We know that valency of carbon is 4 and the valency of oxygen is 2. So we write 4 below C and 2 below oxygen. Now next step is we have to cross multiply to obtain the number of atoms of constituent elements in molecule of a compound. Now cross multiplication, you know very well, C will multiply with 2 and 4 with O. So what happens? This 2 goes at the base of the C and the 4 comes at the base of the oxygen, right? So when we cross multiply it, in the fourth step we obtain C2O4, right? Now in maths, when you solve the problems, you simplify, right? Now here also we have to simplify the number of the atoms. Now when we simplify it, now we have got C2O4. So to write the final molecular formula, the number of constituent atoms in the final molecular formula should be the smallest possible whole numbers. This is how we simplify. And for getting this, we have to divide the formula by a suitable number, right? Now we have received the formula C2O4. Now when we simplify it, we can divide it by 2. Now when we divide it by 2, 2 ones are 2 and 2 twos are 4. So it comes to CO2, right? So the molecular formula of carbon dioxide is CO2. So this is how, if we know the valency, we can easily write the molecular formula of the compound. Students, just to remind, if you remember in your 7th standard, we had studied just the opposite thing. We had the molecular formula and we have found out the valency of the constituent elements, right? But here we write the valency first and then we come to the molecular formula of the compound. So with this, so students, we have finished now with lesson number 6, composition of matter, and in the next coming lecture we are going to discuss the workbook exercise of the same. Please find out the answers, as all the answers are given in the textbook itself. And one more thing I just want to remind you, students, I always tell you that whenever you are having your science online session, please keep your workbook and textbook also with you, so that if you have any doubt, you can immediately ask the same and you can clear the doubts. Okay, students, take care, stay home, stay safe. Thank you.